Hi, today we will talk about the spironolactone and how it acts and what are the possible side effects, drug interactions and precautions with this potassium-sparing diuretic. What is spironolactone? In this name, we can observe the prefix spiro and the suffix lactone. So if we see the structure of the spironolactone, we can observe the spiro linkase. Spiro compound is a compound where the two ring systems are fused directly without any carbon in between them. Here we can observe that two rings are going to be fused with a common carbon. So such type of compound is called spiro compound. And it is having a 5-membered lactone ring system. Lactone is a cyclic ester, and here we can observe the 5-membered lactone ring system present in the spironolactone. So spironolactone is a spiro compound attached with a 5-membered lactone ring system. Now if we observe the structure of the spironolactone, it is having a steroid nucleus, and which type of steroid nucleus it is having? So it is having a steroid nucleus we call pregnane nucleus. Pregnane is a C21 steroid nucleus. And while we are giving the numbering here, this is the 17th carbon and this is the 20th carbon and this is 21st carbon. We can observe the same number of carbons in the spironolactone. This is 17, 20 and 21. But after this 21, we can observe a carbonyl group which is forming an ester. So this is a carbolactone chain which is in between the 17 and 21 carbons. So spironolactone is having a pregnane nucleus with a carbolactone at the 17 and 21 carbons. And apart from these changes, we can also observe a double bond at the fourth position and a keto group at the third position in the spironolactone. So spironolactone is having the pregnane nucleus with the extra double bond at the fourth position and a ketone group at the third position. So we can write the name of the spironolactone as prign4-ene-17-21-carbolactone. Now let us see how the spironolactone acts. This drug acts at the collecting tubules. So suppose this is the inside the lumen and this is the outside the lumen, that is the serum. Now, the inner membrane of the collecting tubules is called as apical membrane and outer membrane is called as basolateral membrane. One of the interesting fact is that the ions cannot pass easily when they are coming at the collecting tubules. For example, ions like the sodium cannot cross easily and they require the specialized ion channels through which the sodium can enter into the membrane. And once the sodium is within the membrane of the collecting tubules, it can be transported out of the membrane by one of the pump, sodium potassium ATPase pump, which is responsible for the transfer of sodium for the exchange of the potassium. Now the sodium is going to be reabsorbed and potassium is excreted into the lumen. As we know that sodium is an important electrolyte, it is going to be reabsorbed at the collecting tubules, and this process is going to be promoted by one of the hormone aldosterone, which acts on the aldosterone receptors. So when the aldosterone binds to the aldosterone receptors, it is going to increase the expression of the sodium channels on the epithelial membrane, which promotes the sodium reabsorption. In this way, aldosterone increases the sodium reabsorption at the collecting tubules. Now let us see how the spironolactone acts. Spironolactone can block these aldosterone receptors, thereby it prevents the action of the aldosterone on the aldosterone receptors. So in this way, spironolactone acts as a competitive antagonist for the aldosterone receptors. But when the spironolactone binds to the aldosterone receptors, it will not promote the expression of the sodium channels, so sodium is not reabsorbed. So spironolactone inhibits the reabsorption of the sodium by inhibition of the expression of sodium channels on the epithelial membrane. By this effect, spironolactone inhibits the sodium reabsorption. When the sodium is not reabsorbed, potassium is not excreted into the lumen, so potassium is retained within the body. So that's why spironolactone is called as potassium-sparing diuretic. It increases the excretion of the sodium but decreases the excretion of the potassium. Now let us see the metabolism of the spironolactone. So this is the structure of the spironolactone, and it can be metabolized to one of the metabolite canrenone. We can observe the structural similarity between the spironolactone and canrenone. So one of the differences is that spironolactone is having the acetyl thio group, which is not present in the canrenone. And instead, canrenone is having a double bond. So what happens in this metabolism? So spironolactone can undergo the hydrolysis where this acetyl thio group is converted to thiol group, and thiol group can be then removed to form a double bond in the canrenone. And again, interestingly, canrenone is having the long half-life compared to the spironolactone, and it is one of the active metabolite of the spironolactone. How it is given? Spironolactone can be given as a tablet form as well as suspension, and sometimes it can also be given as a gel. As a tablet, the dose may be variable from the 25 to 100 mg, and the dose is given according to the clinical use. And as a suspension, it is supplied as a 25 mg per 5 ml. And gel is available at a concentration of 2 to 5% of the concentration of spironolactone. Side effects of the spironolactone. First of all, let us see what are the side effects which are related to the renal actions of the spironolactone. And here we can classify the side effects as the hypers as well as the hypos. So first of all, let us see the hyper side effects. Spironolactone can produce a hyperkalemia because it is a potassium sparing diuretic. It can produce a hyperkalemia because of the potassium sparing effects of the drug. Second effect is the hyperuricemia. Spironolactone can increase the uric acid levels, which may cause the hyperuricemia in the patients. And it can also produce a hyperglycemia, that is the increased levels of the glucose within the body. So these are the three hyper effects that are caused by spironolactone, which are related to its renal actions on the collecting tubules. Now let us see if you have the renal actions which is in the hypo conditions in the body. First one is the hyponatremia. Since the spironolactone results in the loss of sodium, it can cause the hyponatremia. And hypomagnesemia, this is because of the loss of magnesium. Hypocalcemia, this is because of loss of calcium. And spironolactone can also produce a hypovolemia. This is because of the reduced body volume because of loss of all the important ions like the sodium, calcium and magnesium. Now let us see if you have the side effects which are not related with the renal actions of the spironolactone. Spironolactone, because of its steroidal nucleus, it can act on the estrogen receptors, and when the spironolactone binds to these estrogen receptors, it can promote the gynecomastia. Gynecomastia is a condition of enlargement of the breast both in the men as well as in the women. And because of the steroidal action, spironolactone can also produce another condition, amenorrhea. Amenorrhea is a lack of periods in the woman. Now let us see the other side effects of the spironolactone. Spironolactone can also produce the dry mouth and hair growth. Spironolactone can promote the hair growth, so that's why it can be used in the few of the conditions like the hair loss, particularly in the woman. And we can also observe the nausea and vomiting and some of the menstrual irregularities with the use of spironolactone. Drug interactions. Drug interactions of the spironolactone are more important and should be thoroughly checked. First of all, let us see what are the drug interactions which are going to increase the effect of the other drugs by the spironolactone. Spironolactone can increase the effect of antihypertensives like the prazosin and alfuzosin. Since the spironolactone produces the enhanced hypotensive effect by increased excretion of the sodium, it can increase the hypotensive effects of the antihypertensive agents. Similarly, drugs like the AC inhibitors and ARBs, examples include the enalapril and losartan, can also produce a drug interaction with the spironolactone. These category of drugs are going to produce a hyperkalemia, so spironolactone, when it is given along with these drugs, it can increase the hyperkalemia produced by these drugs. Similarly, this drug can interact with the other potassium sparing diuretics like the imlaride and tramadol. Since all these drugs are belonging to the same category, the potassium sparing effect may be enhanced, resulting in the severe hyperkalemia. And increase in the desoxin level may be produced by spironolactone. This is one of an important drug interaction that works by different mechanism. Spironolactone can inhibit the P glycoprotein, which is acting like an efflexing pump. So when this pump is going to be inhibited, desoxin is not excreted, so desoxin levels are increased within the body. So spironolactone can increase the desoxin levels, which may lead to the desoxin toxicity. Now let us see other interactions of the spironolactone. Spironolactone, because it's a diuretic, it can increase the lithium toxicity. Since the spironolactone increases sodium excretion, sodium is more excreted, but lithium is more retained within the body, leading to lithium toxicity. Similarly, the spironolactone can increase the hyperkalemia when it is given with the potassium supplements, and it can also increase the CNS effects like the sedation when it is given with the alcohol. Now let us see what are the precautions that we have to take before the use of the spironolactone. The first one is the hyperkalemia. Just we have seen that spironolactone can produce the hyperkalemia because of the potassium sparing effect. So it can lead to few of the drug interactions with the drugs which also produce the hyperkalemia. So just we have seen that ACE inhibitors and ARBs can increase the potassium levels. So when these drugs are given along with the spironolactone, they can increase the severe hyperkalemia. So this should be thoroughly checked before the spironolactone is given. And another one is the hyperuricemia. Hyperuricemia may cause the risk of the gout in the susceptible patients. So if any patient is having the risk of development of gout, they should avoid the spironolactone. Gynecomastia, this is one of the important precaution, because the gynecomastia is produced by both spironolactone as well as its metabolite canrenone. So any development of symptoms of gynecomastia should be thoroughly checked during the usage of the spironolactone. Risk of tumors. On prolonged usage, spironolactone may develop few of the tumors. So this risk should be assessed before the prolonged use of the spironolactone. Where it is used? Spironolactone is particularly used in the hyperaldosteronism. So spironolactone, because it is a competitive antagonist of the aldosterone, it can be used in the treatment of both primary as well as the secondary hyperaldosteronism. And another important clinical use is then the treatment of edema and severe heart failure conditions, as the spironolactone reduces the body volume by increasing the sodium excretion. It can be used in these two clinical conditions. And another clinical use is in the treatment of hypertension. When our other antihypertensive drugs are not able to control the blood pressure, spironolactone can be given, because it is going to decrease the sodium levels within the body by increasing the sodium excretion. This drug can be used as an off-label purpose in the treatment of acne and hirsutism in the woman. These two conditions are because of the increased androgenic effects in the woman, and since the spironolactone shows the anti-androgenic activity, it can be used in the treatment of acne and hirsutism in the woman. And apart from these, the spironolactone can also be used in the treatment of hair loss in the females. Interestingly, spironolactone can be used in the hirsutism as well as in the hair loss. Hirsutism is the unwanted hair growth where the normally hair growth is not present in the woman. So spironolactone can be used to control this unwanted hair growth, as well as it can be used in the treatment of hair loss, particularly in the scalp, where the hair loss is going to be increased because of the androgenic activity. In such conditions, spironolactone can be again used. So that's about the spironolactone, one of a potassium sparing diuretic, which acts as a competitive antagonist for the aldosterone. And because of inhibition of the aldosterone actions, it decreases the number of sodium channels that are expressed on the epithelial membrane of the collecting tubules. As the number of sodium channels are decreased, sodium reabsorption is going to be inhibited. Potassium is retained within the body, resulting in the potassium sparing effect of the spironolactone. If you like this video, please subscribe to our channel and post your comments in the comment box. Thank you for watching.